our study through the greatest sermon ever preached. I hope you know the answer to this question by now. What's the greatest sermon ever preached? The Sermon on the Mount. Who preached it? Are you sure? You don't sound sure. Who preached the Sermon on the Mount?
Jesus!
Good job, Nash. Preacher in the making right there. The greatest sermon ever preached, not by Adrian Rogers, not by Charles Stanley, not by Billy Graham, not by Charles Haddon Spurgeon, not by R.G. Lee, but by Jesus Christ himself. He preached this message, and he preached it primarily to his disciples. We know this from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says that Jesus sat down, he called his disciples to himself. He's talking to disciples. He's talking to those who have made a transition. They're no longer curious onlookers. They're no longer looking at Jesus with skepticism, not sure about who he is and his claims. They're committed followers. And what he's telling them in this sermon is, here's what comes after. Have you ever wondered that before? What happens after salvation? After I've turned from my sin, after I've trusted in the finished work of Jesus on Calvary, what next? How am I supposed to live? Jesus has left us, his church in this world, as salt, as light. He hasn't brought us home. You don't get saved and then boom, go home. He's left us here for purpose. He wants us to live a certain way. He wants us to be a certain way in order to draw attention to him, in order to glorify our Father, in order that the lost might see it and be saved. For that reason, our study together is called what? I'm glad you asked. I'll tell you what it is. Life after Calvary. Here's how we live after we've been to Calvary. We are in a new chapter in the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount consists of Matthew chapters 5 to 7. We've worked our way through chapter 5. This morning, we're going to begin in chapter 6. To understand what's going on in chapter 6, you got to understand the previous section, chapter 5. Beginning in Matthew chapter 5, verse 20, Jesus tells his disciples and tells us something that should get our attention, something that should be shocking, something that should be alarming. He says, your righteousness has got to exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. The scribes and the Pharisees were the most religious people in Jesus' society. A Pharisee, a typical Pharisee, they had the entire Old Testament memorized in the original language. That's a lot. Their entire life, every moment of their being, was committed to try and keep the Word of God, but there was a problem. There was a problem with them. Somewhere along the way, they had perverted the Word of God. They had perverted it by either taking away from it or adding to it. They wanted to do just the bare minimum. They wanted to do just enough to get by. They didn't care about the motivation behind the action. They cared about appearances. They wanted to look good before people. They wanted everyone to look at them and say, wow, that guy is spiritual. That guy is holy. That guy is righteous. When in reality, their hearts were rotten, messed up, separated from God. Jesus said, you, my disciples, you got to be different. You got to pursue righteousness in a different way. And from verse 20, after he says that, all the way to the end of chapter 5, he starts talking about the way that his disciples were to relate to other people. He said, you got to show your godliness in your horizontal relationships, in the way that you treat your fellow man. And the way that you treat your spouse, and the way that you treat your friends, and the way that you treat your enemy. You've got to show godliness. You've got to show love. You've got to show righteousness if you are my disciple. Now in chapter 6, he's still thinking about that. He's still thinking about what he says in verse 20, that our righteousness has got to exceed that of the Pharisees and the scribes. But the application is a little bit different. Before, he'd been talking about horizontal things, our relationships with one another. Beginning in chapter 6 from verses 1 to 18, he talks about vertical things. He says, the way that you relate to your Creator, the way that you relate to God, if you know me, has got to be different. And in verses 1 to 18, he talks about something called spiritual disciplines, which we're going to talk about more in the message. Spiritual disciplines are just avenues that God has given us to approach Him in order to grow in godliness. Things like prayer, things like the study of Scripture. The scribes and Pharisees, they did these things, but they did them in order that people would see it and say, you good, way to go. Jesus said, no. You practice these things, you make them an integral part of your life for the glory of God alone. This morning we're going to begin talking about three of them that Jesus mentions in verses 1 to 18. We're going to be spending a while in verses 1 to 18. I'll go ahead and tell you that. Probably a couple of months. It includes the Lord's Prayer. How can I cover the Lord's Prayer in just one message? I can't do that. So we're going to spend a long time in this. This morning, our message is going to look at one verse, chapter 6, verse 1, and this is going to be an introduction to spiritual disciplines, how we relate to God as believers. Look at Matthew 6, verse 1. This is all we're thinking about today, but boy, it's a loaded verse. Jesus says, take heed. That's as if he's snapping his fingers. He says, listen up. Listen to what I'm saying. Let me have your attention. Take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father, which is in heaven. May God honor and bless his word this morning. May he teach it to us, and may the Holy Spirit give us the strength to obey it. Ready to?